We are in a chapter called Carbon and its compounds. Today's class is the last part of this particular lesson. Therefore, I wanted to recollect what all I taught in the previous classes. You have to see all the videos by keeping the textbook along with you. The content is like this, very important chapter it is, and very useful and scoring chapter also. Carbon is an element. It is a non-metal. Its atomic number is 6. Electronic configuration is 2, 4. Valence electron is 4. Valency is 4. Therefore, carbon is called the tetravalent element. Carbon cannot become an anion, means it cannot accept electrons. Carbon cannot become a cation, means it cannot donate electrons. Carbon always shares electrons with the neighboring atoms while forming a bond. The sharing, whenever we find sharing of electrons between the atoms, the bond created is called the covalent bond. Therefore, we can say that carbon compounds are covalent compounds. Covalent compounds having a specific set of properties like, first you have to understand the difference between ionic compounds and the covalent compounds. Important. Ionic compounds are there in the chapter called metals. Covalent compounds are there in the chapter called carbon. Now we are doing the lesson carbon. Ionic compounds are solids. Covalent compounds are liquids and gases. Ionic compounds having higher melting point. Covalent compounds having a lesser melting point, lesser boiling point. Ionic compounds are soluble in water. Covalent compounds are insoluble in water. Ionic compounds are good conductor of electricity in solution or in molten state, whereas covalent compounds are poor conductor or bad conductor of electricity. The next one I told you is, carbon compounds are covalent compounds, but carbon compounds are abundant in the nature. Wherever we see, we can see carbon compounds. There are 3 million carbon compounds out there. What makes the carbon compounds so abundant in the nature? That is the versatile character of carbon. The first versatile character what we can see in carbon, only in carbon, is catenation. Catenation is the unique ability of the carbon to link with other carbon atoms by strong covalent bond to form long chain molecule. We can identify 3 different types of catenation: straight chain catenation, branch chain catenation, and the ring chain catenation. Catenation is also seen in some of the elements like silicon. But the bonds created by the carbon is very strong because the carbon is very small among the tetravalent element. The second property what we can say that makes the carbon compound to become abundant in the nature is the tetravalency of the carbon. Carbon can have 4 bonds. It can react with 4 elements. Combining capacity of the carbon is 4. Carbon can form single bond, double bond, triple bond between the atoms. All these characters makes the carbon compound to abundant in the nature. Since carbon compounds are abundant in the nature, it is very difficult to name the carbon compounds. Then here comes a system called IUPAC system, International Union for Pure and Applied Chemistry. They classify the elements and they help us to name the carbon compounds on the basis of catenation and the bonds present in that. The classification of the carbon compounds are like this: open chain, closed chain. Again, they are classified as saturated and unsaturated. Saturated means they should have only single bonds. Unsaturated means double or triple bonds. In the open chain hydrocarbons, we have saturated and unsaturated. Saturated open chain hydrocarbons are called alkanes. They are all ends with the suffix A-N-E. Methane, ethane, propane, butane, pentane, like that. And their general formula is CnH2n+2. And then regarding the unsaturated carbon compounds, we have alkenes and alkynes. Alkenes ends with E-N-E. Ethene, propene, butene, like that. Their general formula is CnH2n. And we have triple bond. Unsaturated carbon compounds having triple bonds. Hydrocarbons having triple bonds. Alkynes ends with Y-N-E. Ethyne, propyne, butyne, like that. Their general formula is CnH2n-2. Once you know the general formula, you can easily write the molecular formula. Same way, in the closed chain hydrocarbons, we have a cyclic saturated, that is called cycloalkanes. The best example is cyclohexane, C6H12, hexagonal ring structure, having 6 carbon atoms and 12 hydrogen atoms. The same way there is one more group called aromatic carbon compounds. There the first member is called the benzene. Benzene is also hexagonal ring structure only. The molecular formula is C6H6. There we the actual ring structure we have a double or triple bond, double or single bonds in the structure, and it, the structure is of the benzene is very important for the examination is concerned, and the structure was given by a German scientist by name Kekulé. After that I told you something how we can write the structural formulae. Structural formula is very important for the examination is concerned. Structural formula for alkanes, alkenes, alkynes, aromatic, benzene, everything we are writing. Next, when you write the carbon compounds of one particular group, we can easily see some type of series there. That series is called homologous series. Every carbon compound is differed by CH2 group. A series of carbon compounds differed from each other by CH2 group is called homologous series. With the help of the homologous series, we can predict the properties, particularly physical properties. Chemical properties are similar, they show similar chemical properties. And the chemical properties can be altered with the help of functional groups or heteroatom. Heteroatom, they are given chlorine and bromine. Chlorine and bromine are the heteroatoms. When a heteroatom is oxygen, we have a functional group like alcohols, aldehydes, carboxylic acid and ketones. Alcohol means OH. It ends with in our alcohol. The name of the alcohol is propanol, OL. Aldehyde group, CHO group. The name example is propanol. Carboxylic group, COOH group. Propanoic acid is an example. And ketone, CO. Propanol is the example. There we have to write the structural formula again. While writing the structural formula, we have to see the prefix and the suffix. Prefix, meth means one carbon atom, eth means two carbon atom, prop means three carbon atom, bute means four carbon atom, five means penta, that is easy. And we have to see both prefix and suffix to write the structural formula, molecular formula. These are all wonderful things explained by the IUPAC system. This is a very lengthy chapter. You have to practice and learn, and you have to see the video again and again, keeping the textbook in your friend. Read the textbook, see the video, read the textbook. By that we can become expert in this particular chapter, and I tell you, this chapter is not going to end in the SLC only. It is a chapter that it starts in 10th standard and it is going to continue in a higher class. Now, we are in a stage of finding the chemical properties of carbon compounds. Chemical properties. See, since carbon compounds are covalent compounds, chemically they are less active. We don't find much of chemical properties related to carbon compounds. In the textbook they are given four different areas of chemical properties. One is called combustion. Second one they are given oxidation. Third one they are given addition reaction. Fourth one is substitution reaction. You have to learn only four different headings regarding the chemical properties of carbon compound. And all these things are our day-to-day activity chemical properties. For example, the first one, we can easily understand what is combustion. Combustion means burning of a material in presence of oxygen. Simple. Burning of a material. If you burn wood, it is nothing but combustion of wood. If you burn gas, combustion of gas. Combustion means what? Burning. To burn anything, the oxygen is required. Therefore, what God is telling in this particular content is carbon in all allotropic forms. Which are the allotropic forms of carbon are there? We have two different categories of allotropic forms of carbon are there. One is crystalline, another one is amorphous. The crystalline we have diamond, graphite and fullerene. In amorphous we have coal, charcoal and lamblack. You can take any allotropic form of carbon and burn at different temperature. because the diamond takes very high temperature. But all allotropic forms of carbon on combustion means burning in presence of oxygen, they are to produce carbon dioxide, the gas which releases by the combustion of carbon, allotropes of carbon is carbon dioxide. Then you think that carbon dioxide is very bad for the environment. No. Burning of the carbon is not only produces carbon dioxide as a chemical gas, it also produces lot of heat. Heat, and even it produces light also. Therefore, carbon is a fuel. Coal is a fuel. The railways, they run with a coal. Burning of coal means burning of carbon. Therefore, carbon is considered as a better fuel because it not only releases carbon dioxide, it produces a large amount of heat and light, and this heat and light is utilized for power purpose. Therefore, the burning of all allotropic form of carbon liberates which gas? Carbon dioxide. What is the advantage of burning? We get large amount of heat. Therefore, carbon is considered as a fuel. Now the next comes carbon compounds. Carbon compounds means, again, we have two different types. One is hydrocarbon. Try to understand. Hydrocarbon is a carbon compound containing only hydrogen and carbon. The another one is carbon compound, means it may contain anything else other than the carbon and hydrogen. If you have a hetero atom, like if I take ethyl alcohol, if I take, this is ethyl alcohol, ethanol. When I take ethyl alcohol or hydrocarbon, on combustion, if we heat, advantage, see, fantastic advantage. Burning of all carbon compounds means burning of hydrocarbon or burning of any carbon compound. All the carbon compounds, they produce only two compounds. That is carbon dioxide and water vapor. Therefore, we can conclude here, all carbon compounds on combustion produces same type of products. The product is same, carbon dioxide and water vapor. Along with this carbon dioxide and water vapor as a material, it also releases energy. It also releases energy in the form of heat or light. Heat or light. Light also form of energy. Heat is also form of energy. Therefore, all carbon compounds, you have to generalize this statement, all carbon compounds on combustion releases heat and light. Along with that, they release carbon dioxide gas and water vapor. Simple it is. Therefore, combustion of all carbon compounds produce same type of product. Now, the amount of heat is going to come from different carbon compounds are different, but the product is same. Now here, fantastic one question is there. Combustion is one of the nicest method of identifying saturated and unsaturated carbon compound. You know that saturated means they have single bonds. Unsaturated means they have double or triple bonds. When they have double or triple bonds, we call it as unsaturated. When they have single bonds, then they are called saturated. Now the question is, when a gas is given to you, how to identify, is it saturated or unsaturated? Testing of saturated or unsaturated, it is done by the process called combustion. You burn saturated on combustion, saturated carbon compound on combustion, always produce smokeless amount of smoke, smokeless blue flame. If you are able to see blue colored flame, then you can say that it is saturated. How nice it is. A carbon compound is there,
You have to check it is saturated or unsaturated. Apply a process of combustion means what? Burn that. If you are getting blue flame, you can say that it is saturated. Suppose if it is unsaturated, apply the same experiment. Apply combustion process. If it is unsaturated on combustion, it produces a smoky yellow flame. If you are seeing yellow colored flame, then you can have an idea it is unsaturated. And lot of smoke is produced here. When the smoke comes from the flame or fuel, we can say that fuel is unsaturated. For example, I tell you, at your home, the gas, I told you, LPG is nothing but butane. Butane is saturated. When you burn the gas stove, you get a blue flame. Smoke is less. Therefore, we can say that butane is saturated. Suppose if you have a kerosene stove, see the flame of the kerosene, yellow flame, kerosene produces yellow flame and a lot of smoke is there. Therefore, kerosene is unsaturated. Right? There is a very fantastic approach of finding saturated and unsaturated. We can easily understand saturated carbon compounds and unsaturated carbon compounds by the process for combustion. The combustion of saturated carbon compounds always produce smokeless blue flame. The combustion of unsaturated carbon compounds produces smoky yellow flame. Right? But here it should be always keep one thing in mind. What is that? Even though carbon compound is saturated, if we don't supply sufficient amount of oxygen, then saturated it also produces smoky flame. Try to understand. Examination they may ask you. In general, combustion of saturated carbon compounds produces smokeless blue flame. But under what condition saturated carbon compounds are also produced smoky yellow flame? They also produce smoky yellow flame. When the oxygen supply is less, when there is a less amount of oxygen in the process of combustion of saturated, then that combustion is called limited supply of oxygen. When the oxygen is given less, even saturated also produces a lot of smoke. Therefore, always during the process of combustion, you have to provide sufficient amount of oxygen. Therefore, that fuel can have a complete combustion. If sometimes the oxygen level is less, then it becomes incomplete combustion. Right? To understand, saturated carbon compounds on combustion has to produce blue flame. But sometimes saturated carbon compound also produce yellow flame when the combustion is incomplete. What is the meaning of the incomplete combustion? The fuel is burning. To burn the fuel, we are not supplying the sufficient amount of oxygen. We have to supply sufficient amount of oxygen. Therefore, as a brilliant student, what you have to do? Go to your kitchen. See the gas flame. Gas flame is blue, then you can say that inside your kitchen, sufficient amount of oxygen is there. Therefore, pollution level is less. Suppose the gas stove is giving a slight yellow flame, then think that in the kitchen, the amount of oxygen is less. Therefore, it is definitely harmful for the person who is standing there and inhaling the same bad air. What you have to do? You have to open the windows. If the exhaust fan is there, put exhaust fan. Make the polluted air to go out. Allow the fresh air to come inside. Then the gas burns with a blue flame. Therefore, the indicator, it acts as an indicator. See, if your mother is cooking in the kitchen and the fuel is burning and the flame is yellow, definitely it harms the health of your mother. Why? Because she is inhaling the pollutant air, the smoky flame, the smoky gas which is coming out of the burning of the butane gas, she is inhaling, it definitely spoils her lungs. What you have to do as a student of science, you have to tell your mother, if the flame is yellow, kindly open the door, open the window, let the fresh air comes into the kitchen. When the fresh air comes into the kitchen, the flame becomes blue. When the flame becomes blue, the pollution amount becomes less. Therefore, we have to always keep in mind, combustion is the first process, chemical process. What is combustion? Burning of a material in presence of oxygen is called the combustion. Burning of carbon in all the allotropic form, it always produces carbon dioxide, releases heat and light, therefore carbon is considered as a fuel. Carbon compounds, all carbon compounds including hydrocarbon as well as carbon compound on combustion produce the same result. The result is carbon dioxide and water vapor. Along with carbon dioxide and water vapor, they release heat and light. How to distinguish between which one is saturated and which one is unsaturated? This unsaturated carbon compounds on combustion has to produce smokeless blue flame when its amount of oxygen given for the combustion should be higher. And unsaturated carbon compounds on combustion produce a smoky yellow flame. Even though when you supply more amount of oxygen, it produces a yellow flame. Always it produces yellow flame. Unsaturated carbon compounds in presence of excess of oxygen or less amount of oxygen, it produces smoky yellow flame. But saturated, when the oxygen supply is sufficient, it produces blue flame. If oxygen supply is less, it produces yellow flame. That is the way we can distinguish between saturated and unsaturated carbon compounds. Second chemical property mentioned in the textbook is oxidation. This is a very common thing. It is oxidation, everybody has to know. What is oxidation? Oxidation is a chemical reaction in which oxygen is added. Addition of oxygen is called oxidation. The opposite of oxidation is reduction. For oxidation and reduction, we require agents. For example, oxidation is a process of addition of oxygen in a chemical reaction. For oxidation, we require oxidizing agent. What is oxidizing agent? Oxidizing agent is a chemical substance. It helps other chemical substance to gain oxygen. You are familiarized with the best oxidizing agent in the chapter called metals, nitric acid. Nitric acid is a very strong oxidizing agent. Right? I repeat, oxidizing agent is a chemical substance. It helps the other chemical substance to gain oxygen. With the help of oxidizing agent, we can make a process chemical reaction called oxidation. Here what happens, we all know that in organic chemistry, we have alcohols. Alcohol means, see, CH3, CH2, OH. It is ethanol. Two carbon atoms are there, therefore ethyl. Alcoholic group means it is ethanol. This ethanol, when it is reacted, heated, when it is heated, but be careful while heating alcohol, you have to take water bath directly. If you heat alcohol, it catches fire. In a water bath, when we heat it with alkaline means basic alkaline, KMnO4, alkaline KMnO4, KMnO4 means potassium permanganate. Potassium permanganate is purple in color. It is purple in color. It is in alkaline medium. When you heat, I make this one proper. Take ethanol, ethyl alcohol, and add small amount of alkaline potassium permanganate. It is completely becomes purple in color. heat with a water bath, means take one vessel, fill water and boil that water and keep this vessel there. Water bath heated, it is going to convert this purple color of the potassium permanganate becomes colorless. Potassium permanganate becomes colorless in acidic medium, means that during the reaction acid is produced. Which acid is produced means the acid produced is CH3COOH. This is ethanoic acid. This is ethanol. Ethanol. This is ethanol. This is ethanoic acid. Therefore, what they tell is, see, here one oxygen is there. Here one more oxygen, two oxygens are there. Therefore, oxygen is added here. Therefore, this reaction is an example for oxidation. For the oxidation process, alkaline potassium permanganate help. Therefore, alkaline potassium permanganate is called oxidizing agent. Which is the oxidizing agent in the conversion of ethanol into ethanoic acid? Alkaline potassium permanganate. Instead of alkaline potassium permanganate, we can use another oxidizing agent called acidified, means in acidic medium, potassium dichromate, K2Cr2O7, potassium dichromate. Potassium dichromate is also a bright orange colored solution, and this can be used as an oxidizing agent. Therefore, two things are used as an oxidizing agent in the conversion of alcohol and organic acid. Those two oxidizing agents are potassium permanganate and potassium dichromate. Potassium dichromate and potassium permanganate are the oxidizing agent by which we can convert an alcohol into organic acid. I repeat once again, what is oxidation? Oxidation means addition of oxygen. For oxidation process, we require oxidizing agents. What are oxidizing agents? Oxidizing agents are chemical substances. They help the other chemical substance to gain oxygen. The oxidizing agent used in the conversion of an alcohol into an organic acid are potassium permanganate and potassium dichromate. And ethanol is converted into ethanoic acid is an example for oxidation of organic compounds. In the textbook they are asked a question, how you can say that conversion of an alcohol into an organic acid is a process of oxidation? Very simple. In ethanol, in the case of ethanol, there is only one oxygen atom. But in the case of ethanoic acid, there are two oxygen atoms. Therefore, there is an increase of one oxygen atom. Therefore, this reaction is a clear example for a process of oxidation. Therefore, the second equation, the second chemical property related to the organic compound is oxidation process, means addition of oxygen. Third chemical property mentioned in the textbook is addition reaction. First one is combustion, means what? Burning of organic compound in presence of oxygen. Combustion means a process of addition of oxygen. Here we added oxygen to alcohol to make it as an organic acid. Now, addition reaction, very important reaction for the life is concerned. See, I write here, addition reaction. For this one, you have to understand certain things. See children, we in general, for cooking, we use oils and fats. Ghee is a fat. Cook groundnut oil, olive oil, sunflower oil, like that, oil. What is the difference between oil and a fat? That you have to understand. I write it here. Oils and thighs. Always you have to understand this. This is very important for our life. The health of the heart is determined by the food what we eat. In our Indian condition, we are normally we are confused with oils and fat. Some people that tell ghee is nice, good, eat lot of ghee. Some people tell no, you should not eat ghee. The reason, learn the science of this. Oils are unsaturated. Oils are unsaturated. Fats are saturated. Do you understand? Oils are unsaturated. Fats are saturated. Oils are, in general, we get it from the plant source. Plant source. Seed. Seeds. Oil seeds we get from the oil seeds. Till that type of oil seeds are there. From the seeds we get oils. Whereas fats are obtained from animal source. Animal source. It is animal source it is. Fats are. Ghee, we are getting it from the cow, milk. The milk is a plant, animal source it is. Therefore, oils are from plant source, fats are from animal source. This oils, since they are unsaturated, they react with oxygen easily and get rancid. Rancid means they produce some sort of foul smell. But if anybody cooks or any dish with oil, if you keep it for 1 or 2 days, you get a smell. That smell is called the rancidity of the oil. That smell is because of the oxidation of the unsaturated carbon compounds. Whereas fats do not undergo rancidity. Therefore, what happened? Any food material made by fat, Mysore pak is made by fat, we can keep it for longer days. Shelf life is more. Therefore, in hotels or bakeries, they always make materials with fats. Why? Because they can store it for longer days. But anything is made by oil, it spoils faster. Therefore, you can't keep it for a longer time. But understand. Fats are not good for heart. Therefore, eating from the bakery, eating in the hotel, made by fats, it is bad for your heart. Therefore, what you have to do is, always, you have to use oils. Oils are good for heart. I can't say that it is good for heart. It is not bad for the heart. But fats are bad for the heart. Therefore, in the society, what they do is, oils are good for cooking. Always you have to cook by oil, not by fats. There are people are having the habit of using lots and lots of ghee, butter, everything. It is not good because it is saturated, it deposits in your bloodstream and it becomes cholesterol, thickening of the blood. It gives a lot of strain to your heart. Oils are unsaturated, very difficult to get digested. Therefore, it may not add to your blood and you may not have, people may not get that much of problem for the heart. Therefore, the difference is, which one is good for health? Is it oil or fat? Oil. But the disadvantage of the oil is, it undergoes rancidity. Therefore, the commercial people, they convert, oils are cheaper, fats are costlier. It is not good for the health, but it is costlier. Because people, they use this more. This is cheaper. Therefore, cheaper oils are converted into fats for making more money, commercial concepts. Conversion of unsaturated oils into saturated fats is called hydrogenation of oils. It is called what? Hydrogenation. hydrogenation of oil. Why they do this? To convert oil into fat. Why they convert oil into fat? Because anything made in fat can keep it for a longer days. Understood? Therefore, in the commercial concept, what they do is they take oil and they convert it in the form of fat, and they cook dishes and they preserve in the glass chambers, and they supply weeks together. It is a commercial concept. Now, the hydrogenation of oil, how they do? They do it. See, if unsaturated oil is here, unsaturated oil, this is, now the example is ethylene. This is unsaturated. Why I call it this as unsaturated? Because it is having a double bond with the carbon atoms. When this unsaturated carbon atoms is heated or treated with hydrogen, you have to add hydrogen, in presence of nickel, in the presence of nickel or palladium as a catalyst, nickel catalyst. Nickel is what? Catalyst. In presence of nickel as a catalyst, this unsaturated carbon compound changes into saturated. It becomes saturated carbon compound. Saturated means what? Single bonds between the carbon atoms. See, the process of, what is addition reaction? The process of converting unsaturated carbon compounds into saturated carbon compounds by heating it with hydrogen in presence of nickel or palladium. Palladium, atomic number 46. Palladium, this is atomic number 28. Nickel or palladium as a catalyst in presence of hydrogen, we can convert unsaturated carbon compounds into saturated carbon compounds, and this type of reaction is called addition reaction because we are adding hydrogen here. Here, how many hydrogen atoms are there? 4. Here, how many hydrogen atoms are there? 6. Hydrogen is added. Therefore, this reaction is called what? Addition reaction. I repeat once again. Actually, the process of converting unsaturated carbon compounds into saturated carbon compounds is called, usually done in hydrogenation of oils. Therefore, students should understand what is the difference between oil and a fat. Oils are unsaturated, fats are saturated. Oils are good for the heart, whereas not bad for the heart, whereas fats are bad for the heart. Not bad for the heart, bad for the heart. Always we have to use oils instead of fats. One more advantage of using fat is the shelf life of the fat is more. It's not going to get rancid. The foul smell you may not get. Therefore, people, what they do is they convert unsaturated oils into saturated fats by a process called hydrogenation. In the process of hydrogenation, the oils are heated with a hydrogen in presence of nickel or palladium as a catalyst. Catalysts are the substances, they help to increase, promote the rate of reaction. Reaction may take place at a faster rate. Such substances are called the catalysts. Nickel and palladium are used as a catalyst in the process of hydrogenation of oil. And this type of reaction is called the addition reaction. Why? Because we are adding hydrogen to the carbon compound. By adding hydrogen atoms, we can break open the double bond or triple bond and make them as single bond. Therefore, in the examination, we may ask you, name the process of converting unsaturated carbon compounds into saturated carbon compounds. The process is called addition reaction. In addition reaction, we require catalyst. Which is the catalyst used in the addition reaction? You remember nickel or palladium. These two catalysts are used to convert, the application is conversion of oil into fat. Conversion of oil into fat is an example for addition reaction. Why we convert oils into fat? Because anything made by fat can be have a better shelf life. To increase the shelf life of the material cooked, we always prefer fats. But it is not good for health. The oils are better for health. This I wanted to explain. I write it here. Substitution reaction. See here, very nice reaction it is. We all know that alkanes, particularly alkanes, alkanes are chemically less active. They are chemically less active. There is no chemical property, chemical reaction formed by alkanes. All alkanes are fuels. The best example is methane. Methane is a fuel. We don't find any much of reaction of methane in any of the chemicals. But this methane, it is so, no doubt it is a chemically inert in nature. It reacts. It reacts with methane, I write methane. This methane reacts with chlorine gas. It reacts with chlorine gas. That too in presence of sunlight. Examination they may ask. Sunlight, in presence of sunlight. Chlorine reacts, or methane reacts with chlorine in presence of sunlight and undergoes substitution reaction. In general, methane is a chemically inert in nature, but it can also react with a very active element called chlorine. But in presence of what? Sunlight. Sunlight is essential for the reaction of methane and chlorine. And what type of reaction we come across? We are going to come across a type of reaction called substitution reaction. What it means? See, methane is having four hydrogen atoms. When it reacts with the chlorine, what this chlorine is doing is, chlorine takes one hydrogen. Chlorine takes one hydrogen. How many hydrogen atom is there? Four. Takes one hydrogen means how many remains? Three. Therefore it becomes what? CH3. See, CH4 is there. One hydrogen is removed by the chlorine and chlorine adds there. Therefore it is called the substitution. In the cricket we tell substitute player. One player goes to the lead field, the another player plays in that particular player. The same way, hydrogen is removed, chlorine is added. Therefore it is called substitution reaction. During substitution reaction, one hydrogen is left. One hydrogen is left, that hydrogen reacts with the chlorine present, one more chlorine is there, to form hydrochloric acid. And this reaction is called substitution reaction. In the place of hydrogen, chlorine substitutes. Therefore, hydrogen number decreases, chlorine number increases. And this compound, see this compound, CH3, Cl, we can call this as chloromethane. This compound is called what? Here I write, it is called chloromethane. It is called chloromethane. And this reaction takes place in presence of sunlight. Right? But this reaction is having a peculiar character. Here the reaction is not going to stop here only. It again continues. See? That chloromethane, CH3Cl, again reacts with chlorine in presence of sunlight. Again reacts with chlorine in presence of sunlight. Here what happens? Again, how many hydrogen is there? Three hydrogen atom is there. It takes one hydrogen and substituted by the chlorine. Therefore, hydrogen 3 is there. It becomes now 2. CH2. And one chlorine is added there. Already one chlorine is there. One more chlorine is added. It becomes Cl. See, you can easily understand. This is CH3Cl. This is CH2Cl2. One hydrogen is decreased. One chlorine is added. Here also we are going to get hydrochloric acid. Then now we have to name this. This is chloromethane. Here how many chlorine is there? 2 chlorine is there. Therefore it is dichloromethane. Dichloromethane. It is called the dichloromethane. 2 chloride ion is there, therefore it is dichloromethane. Here again, the reaction is not going to stop because still hydrogen atom is there. Again, this CH2, Cl2 plus Cl2. What happens? Here, 2 hydrogen atom is there. Again, one hydrogen atom is substituted, chlorine is added. Then it becomes, in presence of what? Sunlight. Sunlight is essential for such reactions. Here, the chlorine hydrogen decreases, the number of hydrogen is decreased. CH2 was there, now it becomes CH. And Cl2 was there, one chlorine is added there. Cl3. Easily you can understand the name of this particular compound. When 2 chlorine is there, I call it as dichloromethane. Here how many chlorine is there? 3. Therefore it should be trichloromethane. Trichloromethane is CHCl3. But this is a very famous compound. What is the famous result? This compound is nothing but chloroform. Chloroform, you know the chloroform. Chloroform is used in the medical field while performing a surgery. A patient is given chloroform before performing a surgery. By that they become unconscious, doctor can safely do surgery. The chloroform, the molecular formula of chloroform is CHCl3. And it is one of the product of the substitution reaction of the methane in presence with chlorine in presence of sunlight. Now the question is this reaction is going to stop now? No, because still hydrogen is there. Still hydrogen is there. Then this becomes CHCl3 plus Cl2. CHCl3 plus Cl2. Again one hydrogen is there, that hydrogen is pulled out. In presence of sunlight, hydrogen is removed, then hydrogen is gone, chlorine has to be increased. The 3 is there, it becomes 4, therefore it becomes C. Hydrogen is gone. Over. Chlorine is added. CCl4. CCl4 plus HCl. Now how to name this? 4 carbon atom, 4 chlorine atom is there. Therefore, this becomes carbon now. We can't say that it is methane. It becomes carbon. Therefore, it is called carbon. Carbon tetrachloride. Carbon tetrachloride. This is the final product. Still, after that, the reaction stops because hydrogen is gone. A series of reactions that takes place when methane reacts with chlorine in presence of sunlight is an example for substitution reaction. See children, it is not required for you to remember all the 4 equations. If you remember the first equation, it is sufficient for substitution reaction for your examination is concerned. I written all the 4 steps. Why? Because you should understand the meaning of the word substitution. Chlorine is substituted in the place of hydrogen. Hydrogen is removed, chlorine is added. And starting with our methane, CH4 ends with CCl4. CH4 means 1 carbon, 4 hydrogen atom. Hydrogen is substituted by chlorine. Therefore, the final product is CCl4, carbon tetrachloride. This is an example for substitution reaction. Examination, they may ask you a question. Under what condition methane reacts with chlorine? Methane reacts with chlorine in presence of sunlight. Right? And undergoes what reaction? Substitution reaction. These are the different chemical equations, chemical reactions given in the textbook for carbonatic compounds. The first one is combustion, second one is oxidation, third one is addition, fourth one is substitution. Any one they may ask in the public examination. I explained all the 4 different chemical reactions given in the textbook.